Here I am in Shroud of the Avatar. I'm standing outside Owl's Head. I'm using my alt account. And in today's video, I'm going to do an introduction to crafting. I'm using my alt character because although I've leveled up quite a few of the resource gathering stuff, I've not done anything in the refining or production. So it's fairly close to a new character on those fronts, to give you an idea. So while I've got the skills open, there are, as you can see, three basic schools. There are five gathering, fishing, which we're not going to go into today, forestry, which is chopping down trees for wood, field dressing, which is skinning animals, foraging, which is for cotton and reagent type stuff, and mining, which is the primary skill we're going to use today as far as gathering resources concerned. So each of the skills has a very similar structure, apart from fishing, you'll see. So just to go over that, this top one is your basic proficiency. This determines your success chance of mining in this case any particular node. Your survey skill is how far away you can see, let's say, air quotes, see nodes from. Your swift gathering gives you bonuses to the speed you do the activity at. A meticulous collection gives you a chance to harvest particular nodes multiple times. It's probably not going to make much sense to you right now, but we'll get to it in a few minutes. You'll notice I've turned off the training on the survey, and in all cases, because the effect you get to show you where the resource is, I find less obvious than actually seeing the resource. But anyway, the refining stuff, which we'll get to later, doesn't have multiple abilities. All of this, of course, is still subject to change. This is like my test video for the final tutorial. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to head to the Owl's Nest mine, which is this way, and we'll do a quick introduction on actually gathering resources, and then we'll head into the mine and I will discuss my strategies for assembling piles of ore. So in we go. So while this is loading, I'll just talk briefly about what's going on. The skills I've showed you there are for resource gathering. The other skills require recipes. Oh, someone's been here before us. So, handily, there's a corpse over there, and this over here is an iron ore node. So you see when I put mouse over it, you get the little pickaxe icon. That's because in the mining thing, I have equipped a pickaxe. So I'm going to double click on the node. And I've got 100% chance of mining this node. So what that indicates to you is that for resources, this is a fairly low level area. Because with my fairly low skill level, I'm guaranteed to be able to harvest that. If I go here, you see the little field dressing and the little sickle thing, not a sickle, skinning knife. And what? 96% chance. Now, oh, here comes a wolf spider. Let's kill him quick. Goodbye, wolf spider. Now, I've chosen this area because despite there being a lot of wolf spiders, it's actually quite easy to get to the mine. We'll get there in a minute. I am just, before we move on, so my field dressing, I've got equipped a skinning knife. What I have in my inventory is a skinning knife with gold engravings, which gives me, as you can see, a bonus three levels and a 30% time bonus. So I'm going to equip that. You'll see it's changed here. Now it's going to be hard to notice if there's any difference because it was fairly quick anyway. But try it and see. Was it actually noticeably quicker? I'll leave you to be the judge. We'll try. There's another spider over here, look. So quickly kill him. Oh, there's two spiders. That's goodbye, spider. Alright, let's see if we spot the speed again. Critical. Right, so let's just talk briefly about critical success chances and all that sort of thing. So normally you just do this thing, it levels up. Different resources take longer or shorter times to harvest. In a low level area like this, I should expect to be able to harvest everything fairly quickly. Let's just skin the wolf, because that might be a more time-consuming activity. Oh, still 96% chance. So because I've done some resource gathering, this is all a bit easy for me. Oh, there's a tree. Good. Let's just do a tree. Oop, I'll level up my cold shield. There we go. So we'll just do them again. So when you harvest nodes, we'll just pause here and have a look. The most common thing from a spider is venom sacs. So you always get a venom sac when you harvest a spider. You sometimes get bonus items. Let's see if we can get some here. No. But you will have seen earlier on, I harvested some spider silk. So everything has a critical success chance in terms of the time, and also you get critical success in that you can get rare resources from some things. So trees often have bark and stuff. So before I harvest this tree, so I've got the plain old harvesting axe equipped, but I have on my person a harvesting axe with gold engravings, and you see that gives me a 30% meticulous collection chance. So let's equip that and let's see. So my meticulous collection chance is 4%, which isn't really much. So let's see if we can meticulous collect the tree. 1 in 3 chance it'll work. You never know. 100% chance. No. Oh well, we'll get some mining stuff inside. I'm sure we'll do it eventually. Right, so here's where we do the foraging. So let's just. So again, I've got a regular sickle equipped, but in my inventory, I have a super duper sickle that gives me the gathering time bonus. I'll equip that. Now you're not seeing much difference because everything's so quick anyway. But that was fairly quick. I think it was a critical success. So you can, ooh, spider. You can get these critical success chances to harvest things instantly, basically. And your chance of a critical success goes up with your level. The chances of there being extra stuff, rare resources, depends on the crafting level more than your own skill. Although if you have a meticulous collection thing, then there's a pretty good chance, because you'll get multiple goes at harvesting things, a pretty good chance that you will get something out of it. Let's just kill him. I'm not in danger of dying, I don't think. Now, in this area, I should point out that up the hill there is a nasty red spider, which probably will kill you, unless you've leveled up a fair bit. When I was testing this out the other night, I did try taking one with this character, and yeah, I ran away. Oh, see, there was spiders up there. I wasn't paying too much attention. So this is all like, oh, spider silk and a spider eye. So spider silk is a reagent for many spells, so it's valuable to pick up. Spider eyes I don't think there's any use for, but at the moment, just sell it. There's another bit of iron over here. I'm just gonna go for it, 100% again. Critical success. You always get granite and iron out of an iron ore node. So there's a few more spiders up here we just need to kill. Get one last iron ore node before we go in. Go on. There we go. Escape from the fire's web. Yeah, so if you are very low level, just run through this whole area. You'll find that spiders are individually weak. If they all spit poison on you, get through you very quickly. Now there is a brown spider up here, which is a bit of a tougher opponent than these wall spiders, but still shouldn't be too much of an issue for me. There we go. And you'll find, because he's a high level creature, I have a lower chance of harvesting from him, 87 as opposed to 96 for other things, but you get more stuff out of him. So I'm just going to nab this bit of iron, because we can use it all. And we're going to head up the hill. See, there's a cotton plant there, and the red spider hides behind that tree. Usually here he is. And see, he's yellow to me, so I'm going to run into the cave and not die. So, Owl's Nest is an excellent place to come and practice your mining, because it's a scene related to a quest, with the result that the people in the scene aren't going to attack you. There are a multitude of things to mine, so that is a medium sapphire crystal. When we get in, there'll be metal and stuff. Let's just mine that when we're passing. I'm going to ignore all of the guys in the mine. All of them. I don't want to spoil the quest for you. So a medium crystal, have a 96% chance. Success! 10 sapphire fragments. So, at this point, it's worth... More sapphire crystals. It's worth talking about your recipe book. So you hit B, that brings up your recipe book. We're going for swords, so we'll be using smelting and blacksmithing. So if you look here, refined materials, you will see iron ingots are 4 iron ore, and copper ingots are 4 copper ore. There's no gold or silver in the mine today. We will talk about some of that later on though. So the magic number we're looking for to make a sword is actually, although you don't know this yet, we'll get to it. To make a sword, we actually need 5 ingots, 5 metal ingots. So what we're looking for is for each ingot, 4, for each sword, 5, so 20 metal ingots to make a sword. So here we are in the mine. You'll see there's all these bandits who basically berate you and tell you to get out the whole time. Ignore them. Here's an iron ore node, so I'm just going to double click on it here, and you'll see straight away I've only got a 50% chance of harvesting this iron vein. So the ones upstairs were 100%. You also know it's taking a lot longer. Now, as you're watching this slow progress, bear in mind the following things. Even if you fail to harvest the node, it still gives you a bonus on your skills, and I'm sitting here with massive amounts of producer experience, so I will benefit whether I harvest it or not. But I harvest it. I've got some iron ore. So, the iron I'm now up to, if we check the inventory, enough iron ore for a single ingot. Now, as with the other, I've currently got a standard pickaxe equipped, but I have brought with me a variety of pickaxes. So gold engravings was what we were using in the other stuff. Now you'll see the gold engraving one gives me a gathering time bonus. The heavy iron gives me a meticulous collection bonus, but gives me a penalty on time. Silver gives me a critical success bonus and a timing bonus, and true bronze gives me +1 mining level, +3 survey distance, which, as I stated, isn't much use, but a 50% mining gathering time bonus. So let's start with the gold one and see how we get on with that. Let's equip the tool. Let's go here and find this other bit of iron ore, and let's see what happens. So, straight off you'll see my chance has gone up to 52% from 50%. I didn't really time it the last time, but let's assume it's going quicker. So what you'll find anywhere where you're harvesting resources is that nodes of a particular type, well, I failed after all that, nodes of a particular type will be the same level of difficulty throughout the area. So all the ore nodes are going to have a similar success chance for me. Although, as I level up my mining by doing this, my percentage chance will go up. And then what you want to achieve is a bit of a trade-off here. So in this particular cave, none of the people are going to attack you, so you can take as long as you like to harvest all the nodes. So if we just return to my inventory, so the gathering time bonus for the meticulous collection chance would be a trade-off you could make here, because you will improve your chances of getting the nodes twice. But on the other hand, because nothing is going to attack you, let's just try equipping that one for now. Because nothing is going to attack you, you're not going to get interrupted. So that's the problem with meticulous collection. If you get interrupted while you're collecting, then you get nothing. Let's see if this is much slower. So you see my percentage of chance has gone down slightly because there's a lower bonus with this tool. It is much slower. Let's see if we get meticulous collection. Well, we're going to wait some time. So let me carry on about the meticulous collection. If you're in an area where baddies will respawn while you're collecting, it could be that while you're in the sequence of meticulous collection, a baddie respawns and attacks you, and you get nothing that was actually part of your meticulous collection, which is a bit annoying. Here we're not going to get attacked, so it might be worth the risk. Go to the meticulous collection. Oh, you got some tungsten. We'll talk about that in a bit. On the other hand, the ore here will respawn fairly rapidly. Let's go to the silver one. What was that one? Critical success chance. So, meticulous collection. The main advantage of meticulous collection is, out of a single node of copper, you have a chance of getting 2, 3, 4, or 5 copper ore items. But because all of this stuff respawns fairly regularly, the value in this case of meticulous collection is reduced. So you saw just a minute ago, I got some tungsten. So from iron ore nodes, you can get, you always get granite, you always get iron ore. You can get tungsten, which is valuable to NPC vendors, but currently useless. Oh, we're failing a lot now. See, I'm still leveling up though, even though I'm failing. Yeah, tungsten's currently useless. And then you get nickel, which can be used to turn iron ore into, I think it's white iron ore, but I might be wrong, or meteorite iron ore. Copper nodes always give you granite, always give you copper ore. They can also give you tin, which can be combined with iron ore or iron ingots or copper ingots, and zinc, which again is valuable to NPC vendors but useless as far as crafting is concerned. So just to explain my general strategy here, I'm going around and harvesting all the ore nodes. I'm then going to harvest all the crystal nodes, and then I'm going to move on to the next room in the mine and do the same thing. Let's see, I'll not use the bronze one. So that one looks like the best option in this case, because it will improve, it'll improve the speed I'm mining at, and because I know everything will respawn, that's, it's the speed I'm after. So let's just check, is there any more metal lying around? No, so let's get these two crystals. Boom. Sapphire fragments we'll talk about in a bit, after I get into the second room. Now you see, mining the sapphire fragments does level you up. So, even if you've no interest in sapphires, it's worth doing while you're waiting. Nothing here, so there's a lot of sapphire in here. Right, so in here is the only two bad guys. So, if you're lower level, try and draw one of them out and defeat them one at a time. Oh, go on. Go on, 61% chance. How many times did I just fail that? It's ridiculous. There we go. These are gonna. There we go. So we'll quickly harvest these guys. So there's quite a lot of ore in this room. Now, wolves and other creatures can give you suet, which is a useful component in softened leather. The higher level the enemy, the more chance you have of getting things like suet. Cotton nodes give you beetle carapace, which lets you make hardened leather, and also carapacean cloth. You can see with this pickaxe, stuff's going quicker. So I'm going to go around this room and I'm going to harvest all the ore and then all the crystals and then move on to the next one. So while I'm doing that, Oh, see, tungsten. There we go. Not useful to anybody, but they're all the same. While I'm doing that, let's review the recipe book. So smelting, as we saw, has ingots, and then blacksmithing. Let's just get this though. Blacksmithing has weapons and components. So have a starter recipe. I'm not harvesting. Harvest. My starting recipe, I get an iron hilt and an iron dagger blade as starting recipes. We're going to make a sword, which we don't know how to make yet, but we'll go through that. Tungsten again, very exciting. And the next bit of metal to harvest. So, when I get back to Owl's Head, we will look at the recipes in more detail and discuss how to get on. The last thing I want to show you at this point is alchemy. Oh, I failed again. Nope. Oh, we got it. It was behind the book. Alchemy. Let's put that away and find the next node. There we go. So, alchemy. Although we've not got any alchemy recipes. Alchemy is how you get these engraving kits. It's also how you enchant weapons for bonuses and insert gems into weapons to give you affinity bonuses on particular bits of armour. So if you look at my pole arm, I've got Socket of Tempestry, which means I put a Tempestry gem, which is manufactured from a sapphire, into sockets, or nickel, so that's actually useful, into sockets in my weapon, and that gives me plus 20 water attunement on this character. So, there's just a few more metal nodes to be harvested, then I'll whiz around quickly and do the crystals. So the crystals tend to regenerate very quickly, which is why I leave them till last, because that gives you something to do while you're waiting for the ore nodes to regenerate, which sometimes take a bit longer. You sometimes get full sapphires out of the crystals, otherwise you can manufacture with alchemy sapphires out of 400 sapphire crystals. Oh, failed. Go. So let's just switch this over to ore. See what I've worked on so far. I've not been in here long. I've got within the mine 7 iron and 5 copper. I've got the 3 iron ore outside. What I'm aiming for in here is a total of 40 of each. Enough to make 4 swords in total. I'm not going to show all of that. Look at all of that stuff I've got. So that was a meticulous collection while I was chatting away. And see, I've got 2 lots of copper ore, 2 lots of granite, and I also got some bonus stuff. Yeah, so I'm aiming for 40 ore. I will shortly cut the video. I'm just going to mine all of these crystals, go to the next room. Failed. Come on. We're levelling up our mining stuff hard, don't look how it's going. 11 crystals. I'll show you the final room, and then I will come back to the first room there and show you how stuff has respawned. I'm saying that's what I'm going to do. Of course, it might not respawn. I'm pretty confident it will, though. See that crystal? That crystal respawned while my back was turned. Did you see that? I think this one is actually bugged, because it seems to come back there. See, I've got a whole sapphire. That's one of the critical chance results out of mining these crystal nodes. can find there are different crystal nodes in different mines all over the place. I've not found many of the others yet. I'm stuck with sapphires, and I'm buying the other crystals for my other character. I don't want to have fire affinity. The crystals tend to associate, the colour associates them with a particular magic branch, and then when you socket them into weapons, they give you the affinity bonus, as I showed you. Right, a couple more crystals. There we go. Dun, dun, dun. Oh, the meticulous collection, you see. There we go again. Not that we get much out of it. Right, so we cleaned out that room. There is some ore that spawns in this corridor sometimes. It's not there at the minute. The third room is down this way. Again, these guys won't attack you. Crystal, let's see if there's any ore. Now there is sometimes ore in here, there's sometimes ore over there. I can't see any ore at this time though, so let's grab the crystals. So, just to review progress, of the 80 ore I'm looking to collect, I have 17 at this time. If we look for a moment at the... I've already got whole sapphire and it's going to be about 2/5 of another sapphire by the time I finish this room. I'm not sure exactly how long I've been going at this point, but it's probably about 20 or 25 minutes, which is all a prelude to why I'm saying I'm going to collect 40 iron and 40 copper ore. I would expect during that time I will end up with well over 400 sapphire fragments and two or three actual sapphires, and I envisage it taking an hour and a half to 2 hours to get the 80 ore. So we're back here. Right, so you see immediately there's some here by the door that's spawned while we've been down in the other rooms. So the basic strategy is to go around these three rooms in sequence, collect ore, collect as much as you can carry, and then head home. When I say home, I mean Owl's Nest. So that's what I'm going to be doing for the next 40 minutes to an hour. And we'll cut the video here and see you then when I've finished. Alright, so I'm still in the Owl's Nest mines. You can see I've exceeded my target of 40 copper ore. I'm nearly at my 39 copper ore. I am slightly encumbered, but not anything that's going to be of any great impact. There's some iron ore over here which should give me the 40 I set out for. Now it is nice to get multiples of 4 obviously, but not that worried. I'm going to have a little bit of spare copper ore, success. Ooh, some nickel. So we've got everything down here. What I'm going to do is just on my way out check the final room one last time. A bit more ore. And while that's getting mined, I'll harvest a crystal. Should be correct. You'll notice I've leveled up 24, 27, 25 on my mining things. There's a crystal there. There's no ore. Oh, some more copper. Let's grab it. Grab that. All right. So I've got. It's going to be 86 ore. Let's just check the. I've recovered 6 sapphires and enough fragments to build 2 more if I was that way inclined. Failure. And granite block. I've got 167 granite blocks, which is the bulk of the encumbrance at this point. Now, it is important to note that I basically used up. Oh, there we go. Used up one of my pickaxes. I had about 60 ore by the time that was broken. So it's actually an important tip if you're going on a major harvesting run. Take at least 2 of whatever your harvesting implement is, because there's nothing more frustrating than getting. There's just been a few more nodes to harvest and you can't do it because you don't have a tool to do it anymore. You can also take tool repair kits, like you get weapon repair kits. I'm not going to bother with any more crystals, I've got loads of it. So there we go. That's basically enough ore for 4 swords. So that's what we're going to aim for. I'm going to head up. So, I'm in Owl's Head, ready to start my crafting. I've cheated a little bit because I've nipped to my house in order to pick up some extra supplies for demonstration purposes. So, let's see if we can get some light. And we're sprinting. So, Owl's Head is a good location for crafting because it has, in easy proximity, a set of crafting stations and recipe merchants. I will discuss them all shortly. Let's get up to the crafting station first, though. Killing the animals again. So, here is the Owl's Head crafting station. Ronald is the vendor. We'll talk to him in a minute. We have a crafting trainer called Handak, and Emily, a crafting goods merchant. So, if we just review our recipe book, you will see that. We possess some smelting tongs. We do not have an ingot mould, and we do not have chunks of coal. So in order to turn our iron ore into ingots, we need coal and an ingot mould. So coal's a consumable, and an ingot mould is just a piece of equipment. So let's just grab one of them. Let's take all the coal. There we go. While we're here, if you remember, I mentioned useless stuff you get, like zinc. Of course, by the time you're watching this video, zinc might not be useless, but for now it is. And tungsten. Zinc and tungsten, both currently useless. Not part of any recipe, but NPCs value them highly. Approximately half the value they show up is in your inventory, as with all NPC merchants, but that's going to pay for my coal and my ingot mould rather comfortably and make me a profit. That was all picked up harvesting. So you see there's different crafting stations for different things all lying around. We want smelting, which is this one here. So, your recipes appear down here. Your ingredients in this little window here. Your equipped tool there. I'm going to start with making a copper ingot. Let's go for that. Double click. Now it suggests I'm going to have a 53% success chance with my crafting a copper ingot. So if I fail, I will use up the chunk of coal that will do wear and tear my ingot mould, but I'll keep the copper ore. So let's try it and see what happens. We didn't make anything. So let's try again. There we go. We have a copper ingot. So, because I leveled some stuff up there, I'm hoping, did my chance go up? Not really. So, while we're doing copper ingots, let's do the bulk crafting. So this thing here will let me attempt to craft up to 10 items because I have enough copper ore to craft 10 of them. It will let you go up to 20 if you have the resources. So let's do that. And with a percentage, we'd expect to end up with 5 ingots out of that. Plus the one made already, should be on 6. Come on. See, the success chance is going up all the time. And our equip tool is degrading. That is our ingot mould. We're up to 56% now. So what have we got? Yep, that worked out about right. Let's try some more. So we're getting through it. We can still do 3. Right. 2 more. Let's go. Success. 1 more. So there we go. Now I did pick up a bunch of gold. I just want to click on that. Now you notice here the gold ingot has a 26% success chance. I'm not going to craft one right now. I just wanted to show you what the percentage was. If I'm doing an iron ingot, more than twice as much. So remember that, 26%. Well, we'll check again after we've done the iron ingots. Let's go. Failure. So, it doesn't... I mean, the maximum of 20 items means you can't just leave it crafting stuff for you for a long time, but it will give you an opportunity to go and make a cup of tea if you are, or at least start making a cup of tea. Let's just scroll down. 6 iron ingots. Well, not too bad. I think we've got 6 out of 10. We've really used up our smelting tongs. Take all. Right, so we've got 10 iron ingots, we've got 11 copper ingots. Now, as I told you, it takes 5 to make a sword, although, as we reviewed, we can make the hilts, 10 of 2. We don't know how to make actual swords, though. Let's see. Weapons. So we can make a dagger with a metal dagger blade and a metal hilt. But we want to make a sword. That's what we're trying to make. So I'm going to head on back down this way past all the dead animals. So sad. And we're going to go into this shop next to where the adventure trainer is. And in here we have 3 crafting type people. Now these guys sell nearly all of the recipes available in the game. There's a few special ones they don't sell, which I'm not going to bother discussing now. So you see this guy has those engraving kits that I was using in my tools, a lot of food related stuff, and a lot of alchemy related stuff. Edna, that's that guy. We'll move on to this guy, Harold. He's got dye, he's got cloth, house decorations. Now one thing I wanted to look for here. Oh, he's not got them. He's got decorations but not anything to do with walls. Okay, fine. So the final guy, he's the one, lead crafter. So what we're looking for is a longsword, iron longsword blade, copper longsword blade. So we'll buy the iron longsword blade recipe. The other thing, let's just see if we've got one. Right. I'm going to buy a tall medium stone wall recipe. So I'm just buying those two. And it doesn't immediately, it doesn't automatically add them. You can sell those recipes on if you want. So what I'm going to do is look at these recipes, double click on the recipe, it'll open up the recipe book, and you'll see that the longsword blade is 3 ingots, where the dagger blade is 2 ingots. I'm going to click on that as well. Smelting, granite block, stone chisel. So, the granite stuff, which you have no choice but to collect when you're mining iron and copper. If I buy a stone chisel, let's just run back to the crafting supply woman. I wanted a stone chisel. There we go. 50 gold. So the advantage of the granite recipes in the smelting front is that it doesn't have any consumables. So if I click that, I can craft, even though it's 59, I succeeded anyway, even though it's 59%, I can just keep hacking away at it until I succeed. So the stone walls themselves are of no use to me, but what I do like is that you can level up your smelting without burning up chunks of coal. So in contrast to what I recently did, as you just watched, I would recommend you use a poly granite first to level up your smelting and then start making your ingots and stuff. And then, I don't know, throw away the walls or try selling one a vendor. It doesn't really matter. So we're gonna go blacksmithing. So here are our recipes again. So we now have to make a dagger that requires a blade and a hilt and a smithing hammer. And we now have to make a dagger blade, an iron hilt, an iron longsword blade. So let's start off by making an iron hilt. Craft 53%, let's go for it. There we go. Let's attempt an iron longsword blade. Oh, I didn't buy the longsword blade mold. Silly me. That's what you get for not looking at the recipes. And that's why it's handy to do crafting in the vicinity of merchants. So, where was I? Longsword blade. So I made an iron longsword blade. Well, I will have in a minute. There we go. So, I don't have the recipe for a sword, particularly an iron sword, but I do have the recipe for a dagger, and that basically involves putting a hilt and a blade and three chunks of coal together on the crafting table. So let's see what happens. So we have a button, the button lights up, and we have unknown recipe, 12% success chance. Now it didn't work, I've used up my three coal. But, let's scroll up and down. Now, I've learned the recipe for long swords. So, you don't have to buy the recipes at the shop. It is possible to look them up on the internet. It's also possible to just experiment a bit and try working them out. We might have to go and buy some more coal. But eventually, we'll get a longsword out of this. Well, that's 12. It's 1 in 8 chance, isn't it? Well, it's 13% now. I'm just going to keep hacking away. I've still got plenty of coal, and I'm just going to have a go and buy some more. I know it's not great video viewing. Success! Iron longsword. So, you will see the iron blade gives a particular bonus, the iron hilt gives a particular bonus, and both bonuses apply in the final weapon. So let's take all that and let's now look. So we know an iron hilt is 2 iron ingots, so let's take 2 copper ingots. And a chunk of coal. And the button lights up. 55% chance. But I think we just learned how to make a copper hilt. Let's try that again. We'll get there in the end. All this time I'm leveling this stuff up. Copper hilt. Now while we're busy with that, I'm just going to make the second one. Exciting. So, sometimes stuff fails, but you have the opportunity to recover it by just spending more of the fuel, which I'm going to do. I mean, why wouldn't I? So I've now got 2 copper hilts. I'm going to make one more iron hilt as well, just to complete the set. Recover that item too. Still didn't work. Let's try again. So, I can make another iron longsword blade. But instead of that, I'm going to... 1, 2, 3... make a copper longsword blade. Oopsie. Scroll up. There we go. I'm going to make one more of them. Eventually. So we've got a copper longsword blade. That's just while we're doing longsword blades. Make another iron one. So yeah. I wanted 40 ore of each type so that I could make 4 swords. So now, we still have the recipe for the longsword blade, for the longsword. So, I've got a copper longsword blade, stack of 2 of them. I've got a copper hilt. 3 chunks of coal. And away we go. But I just learnt how to make a copper longsword. Although we just have the one recipe. So keep flinging coal into it. This is where it gets a bit awkward. In that this is just looking for metal stuff. It's not going to ask you which particular type. So I don't want to double click and let it mess up what I'm trying to make. I'm up to 16% already on my longsword manufacture. I've not run out of coal just yet, but I'll have to go and buy another 99. Come on. Attempt. Failure. Go and buy more coal and come back and have another go. Nice, it says she only has 99, but she never really runs out. I can afford to buy plenty more. I'm now encumbered because of all the coal I'm carrying. Entertaining, eh? So back to my copper longsword. Copper hilt. Up to 17% success rate now. We'll get there in the end. You might want to skip ahead in the video though. Press the fast forward button. Still not there. And like I said, it is a 1 in 8 chance. Well, it's not even that anymore. We're getting close to a 1 in 5 chance. We're still not succeeding, though. The way random numbers work in Charlie Avatar is probably, once I get it to work, I'll get like 3 consecutive swords out. No problem. Still no. And this rate, my smithing hammer is going to die before I get the sword made. Hey, copper longsword. Now, you will notice that it has different stats. Copper gives you a critical weapon chance. So, the iron longsword, weapon damage, copper longsword, weapon critical chance. So it depends what sort of character you're going for, which sort of sword you go for. You don't have to settle, right? I can make one. Copper hilt, three chunks of coal, come on, you're right, now it's the same success chance, it's still a sword, ah, immediately I made an iron longsword with a copper hilt, so I get plus one weapon damage and plus 1% weapon critical chance. You can of course do it the other way around. You'll be seeing now why I wanted 40 ore. A copper blade with an iron hilt. Broken my smithing hammer at this point, so I need to go and buy a new one of them. You can see how the cost of crafting soon adds up. Now, there are indestructible tools you can buy on the add-on store, which also give you bonuses for doing various things, mostly critical chance, I think, which can cut out some of the tedium involved in learning all this stuff. Let's see what it does. Iron hilt, longsword blade. Crypto. Destroy item. Craft. Didn't work. We'll get there in the end. Success chance. I've got plenty of coal now, but I can wait this out. There we go, copper longsword. Plus 5% critical chance, plus 0.1 weapon damage. It's obviously the same combinations as before. So I've made some swords. You will of course have noticed I don't use a sword with this character, so the swords aren't for me. We're going to head down now to see Ronald. So Ronald is a vendor. So he has a public vendor, I should say. He has a bunch of stuff that players have put up for sale. And you will see place. Lots of things. People are selling zinc. I don't know why anyone would buy that. So, you also see, if I click on manage inventory, I'm selling 2 sapphires. And if we look on manage orders, I've placed an order of 2 emeralds. So we'll just go through all of this. All of this works. I want to sell those swords I've just made. So I'm going to have a look and see. We have these various enchanted long swords. We're not going to sell them for that much. There's a copper long sword. $200,000, right, so that's the sort of price range is more what we can probably get for ours. I'm going to go for cheap though. So manage inventory, let's just get the long swords down. So here are my 4 swords. You'll see they have exactly the same value as a regular non-bonus NPC sword, which is kind of annoying. But anyway, I'm going to drag it across. I'm going to set a price of 1,000. Now you'll see I'm paying a non-refundable fee of 110 gold, so you've got to have money. After 7 days, I will get 55 gold as a refund if it doesn't sell, so I should come and get it back. I guess, you know, what am I going to do? I'm going to send the select anyway for that much. I'll sign for the listing. So I've listed my copper longsword with the iron hilt for 1,000 gold, and that will now appear here. Now let's list the other one, also for 1,000. Now, I don't really expect those things to sell, because as you see, a noob crafter could make them. I'm not going to bother listing the iron ones. But what I will do is, I did pick up a whole load of tin. Now, tin tends to sell quite well. So let's stick 3 tin on for 2,000. And see how that goes. So with the regular listing, the vendor is, I see I've got the cheapest tin by far, so probably someone will buy the tin to resell it at the higher price, which will suit me, because then I can show you what happens when you succeed in selling stuff. We'll see how it goes. Now I might want to buy something, so let's have a look at orders. So when you're selling stuff, the seller pays a fee, and you're managing orders, so we'll see here. So I can get 1,000 gold straight up by selling 3 nickel I have in stock. Now, as you've seen, there's that's mine. As you've seen, there are 2,000 for 3 is the going rate, or 3,000 for 3. But I'll sell 3 nickel. I think I've got. Let me just see how much nickel I've got. I've got 6, so I could actually fulfil both that guy's orders. But anyway, let's sell 3. Sign for exchange. Oop. Let's get it back. Let's see what happened there. I think. There you go. So I've sold 3 nickel to the gentleman for 1,000 gold. So in this case, the guy putting the listing has paid the fee. So So if we look down here, excuse me, I can pick a whole lot of things that I might want to buy. A duck carcass, cool. So my emerald, 2 emeralds for 1,000 isn't being taken up on at the minute. So maybe I should put in a different emerald offer. Let's see what's down here. Salt ingot. So mostly in these things, it's components and refined materials rather than although you've got garnets and emeralds, you don't see emerald gems. But let's see, I've got... So you have to pay the money up, put the money up right now. So if I... Let's do another emerald. Quantity 1. 1,000. And again, I'm paying a non-refundable listing fee. I will get 1,000 gold back if it doesn't sell in the next 7 days. So let's sign for listing. And we'll see if that does better than my original listing. So my tin hasn't sold yet. But you never know. There is, so when stuff does sell, you have to go up the bank. So let's quickly trundle up there now. We'll see if anyone buys anything while I'm running. I don't think I've succeeded in selling anything. So the banking house, Ed, you should probably know where it is. But it's up here. Let's have a quick look. Oh, I've got lots of extra ore. And some nickel. And some granite blocks. But nothing I've sold. So what I'm gonna do... grab all that extra ore and the nickel and take it with me. Just have a quick look back down at the vendor. Sorry, ma'am. Someone waved at me and I didn't notice. Sorry, William Serenite. Nice wings. Knight Commander Montague, right. Montaigne. So I can now fulfill a couple more orders here. And get some extra gold. The advantage there, of course, is immediate money for me, rather than if I listed it on the buy section. Wouldn't necessarily see the money for many hours, days. But I like having money. So, that's how the vendors work. You've seen the crafting stations. You've seen the recipe shop. There is one more thing I will show you. Let's just return back to the smelting table. And we discussed before the chance of making a gold ingot. So it's 28% success chance. So I'm going to leave our set now and head down. I will edit the video at this point. Okay, so for the last part of this video, I'm heading back to Diamond Fields, which is where my main character has a house. This will probably take a few minutes, but I'm heading for there. That's what I want. So feel free to skip ahead until you see me in the town. I will rub it on while I'm travelling. So we've really only done smelting and blacksmithing. You've seen the attempt recipes at very low percentage chances and use up large amounts of resources. But the plus side of that is that, you know, look at all that producer experience I've got. So I'm going to head to Diamond Fields, well, Port Phoenix, and then Diamond Fields, going the long way around to avoid going through any of the control points. So I need to go up here, get on this road, there we go. See, I'm kind of fine with throwing away resources to level up my crafting and stuff. I think you're going to have to do that at the early levels. With my main character, I've got the more powerful tools. Sanctus Spine, don't want to go in there. Let me level stuff up a bit faster. The main benefit of attempting the difficult things is that you get more experience out of it, basically. So, can't check for sure, but I think I've got at least as much producer experience now as when I started this video, now getting on for 3 hours ago. Over the hill. Down here, what's it? Discord ruins. It's all quite picturesque, really. So we go around it. And then we want to head towards not Ardorous. Airy is what we're heading towards. Well, I think we'll probably have to go this way. Wrong. I'll just be redoing this part of the video. It's looking more promising. Right, so here we are coming up, I think, to Superstition Canyon. There it is. Superstition Canyon in the distance. So we're nearly there, and we have been going the right way this whole time, which is always good. Oopsie. The engraved tools came in this release, and they do add something to everything. Like I was explaining, or I was trying to explain earlier, you maybe didn't get the gist of it. They add an element of strategy. You know, what are you actually trying to achieve? Now, in some areas you'll go, some of the mines, once you mine a node, it doesn't come back until the whole scene gets reset, which of course you could hack by just resetting the scene. But at that point you maybe want to have as high a meticulous collection chance as possible to maximise the amount of resources you get out of each node. Whereas the scene I was in, where stuff just respawns while you're standing there, essentially. Collecting all as fast as possible, that's probably a better strategy. So the toolkits themselves, I've been trying to sell some. I've not really been selling that well on the vendor, but should be interesting. People that have not shelled out real money for the indestructible tools in the add-on store will presumably be buying all that stuff. Come final wipe, so it's quite interesting. The enchantment stuff I've not covered in this video, but that's all in alchemy. So one of the things that may change is that there may be more stuff put in the things that are not alchemy for making, you know, good weapons and stuff. Because at the minute, if you don't do alchemy, then you're essentially not going to make top end weapons. Alright, to import Phoenix, go, sprint. I'm not really sprinting. Am I sprinting? Oh, there we go. Now we're using the focus. So I must be sprinting. So, the reason I like living in Diamond Fields rather than Port Phoenix is that I can just teleport home and not have to run a long way down to the docks just to get to the next boat. The entrance and the exits are all very close together in Diamond Fields. It's quite good like that. Port Phoenix is a bit of a bigger town, I think, and involves more running about. So, if you've been skipping over my ramblings, just to see me get to the next bit, we're nearly there. I just need to go down to the docks here and get on my boat, and we will be at Diamond Fields. There it is. Shouldn't take long. I'm usually the only avatar around at the time when I log on. I don't think anyone else is really using it at the minute. I would recommend it though, especially if you've got a village lot, you can, or a row lot. There are plenty of houses in easy reach of the crafting stations, which is what we're here to look at. We'll go up the hill. That rather lovely village home over there, and we're going to head over here to this crafting pavilion. Have a nice banker, have a crafting merchant, which is handy, and over here we have a smelting station. Now you'll notice this is not just any smelting station, it's a benefactor expert smelting station. So let's just go in here. Now, you remember gold ingots, 28% chance when I was in Owl's Head. 57 success chance, plus 11% craft bonus for using benefactor expectations. So, clear benefits of coming and crafting here. Let's go for it. I made a gold ingot, woohoo! Let's make some more. So these crafting stations are only available to some of the high level pledges, but a lot of people who've got player-owned towns have made sure to get a full suite of these benefactor level crafting stations as one of the draws to get people to come. Certainly one of the main reasons I'm here with the village lot. Show you some other discovered recipes. Have we got any ingots left? Ingots. Silver ingot. No, I've sold all the ingots. But I've got some white iron ingots that I prepared earlier. So white iron is made by combining, is it tin? Two iron ingots, tin, and a pile of coal, and you get white iron ingots. You can also make bronze with tin and copper. So that's just what I'm going to do with that. So let's do two white iron. I don't know if we've got any other things. A chunk of coal. Unlearned recipe, 57% success chance. Oh, let's try it again. White iron hilt. There we go, nice. Now we're going for a longsword blade. Chunk of coal, smithing hammer. Longsword blade mould. And my white iron ingots. Made a white iron longsword blade, and now I can make a white iron longsword. And it's 37% chance. A lot better than what I was getting in Owl's Head. White iron longsword. So you see that compared to the iron longsword. Let's just get that up. Right, so the all iron longsword was this one. So plus 1 weapon damage, plus 0.1 weapon damage. See how the white iron has different properties to the actual iron. Damage avoidance, and a similar amount of weapon damage, but not quite as much. So, one last thing, let's just get a repair kit, let's get rid of him, put a blacksmithing repair kit on, let's get my Constantine Halberd of Tempestry, and I can't repair it. I need red coal. Oh, because the halberd is... Oh, I'm on my pit. The halberd is a woodworking weapon. That's what you get for being a prat. Have I got a woodworking repair kit? Yes, I have. Carpentering, not a woodworking. So let's... halberd. Just show you the repairing. So repair means apply the repair kit to the halberd. If you repair on a crafting station, you restore the maximum durability. If you just use the repair kit directly on stuff, it will only increase up to what your current maximum is. So at this point it'd be 93. Salvage breaks down the thing into its component parts. So that's if you want to make metal scrap, that's handy. I'm going to repair it. Not that it really needs repairing, but just to show you. You see it's gone back up to 100. It'll probably tell me here exactly what it did. secondary, 15 points of secondary ability, 7 of primary, and also I think we probably leveled up in repair. Yes, there you go. So that's how you repair stuff. Handy to know. Let's re-equip my rather spiffy halberd. And so there you go. That's crafting a Shroud of the Avatar in my usual long-winded way. I like to do videos where you just run around and actually do all the things rather than edit clips together, so you can always see the full sequence of everything that's going on. That's what I'm aiming for. I don't know if people find that very useful. Possibly not. For you people watch them, but I'm going to keep doing like that. I will probably do a air quotes real crafting video after final white, once all the crafting stuff has been finalised. This stuff I've shown you today could all change next week. I don't think all of it will, some of it might. But yeah, for now, that's my video on how to do crafting.